Alright, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode where I'm wearing my Growing Your Greens t-shirt, which are still available at compassion-tees.com. If you support me and buy a t-shirt, 100% of the proceeds go towards a women-owned minority business, actually my former video editor, so she would appreciate that. Anyways, for a limited time until they're out. So, in this episode, I'm still here in Phoenix, Arizona, and I'm actually outside the house of Greg Peterson. No, it's not that house there with the lawn, because actually most of the houses on this block here in Phoenix actually have a lawn. It is a flood-irrigated neighborhood, so basically they get a really low price on water, so they can actually have a nice lawn. But instead of using the water for growing a lawn, Greg is growing food. You can see this amazing, basically, hedge. He grew citrus trees as a hedge, something that he really likes to do a lot, and I would encourage you guys to do. It creates a nice privacy barrier, but more importantly, grows you something you can eat. So let's go ahead and pivot over to this side so you can see what he's got growing on. That's his front hedge there. As you walk by it, it just smells of like citrus. It's all citrus flowers right now because it is currently March. What I wanted to do in this episode is actually show you guys what Greg has been up to for the last, I think, 5 or 6 years. I'll post a link down below when I visited Greg literally 5 or 6 years ago. It's been quite a while, and you can see the progression that has changed here. You know, when I came previously, he was like, more farming it and actually selling at the farmer's market locally. Nowadays, he's selling it a little bit easier because of the COVID, and he's working from home. He's made some amazing online courses so you could share from his wealth of knowledge, plus others that he will connect you with his online university. You could check and learn more about him at urbanfarm.org. Yes, that's his website. So anyways, he's been in this house here for 32 years. So let's see what he's got growing on after all these years. So the amazing thing about Greg is that this guy is just in a standard residential home, not a big lot or anything. He's not on acreage, but he is a farmer. You could be a farmer even if you have a small lot. You could produce a lot of food if you do it properly. One of the ways you guys can do it properly is by basically filling every square inch with something you guys can eat. So, normally you guys have a driveway, and then off to the driveway, you might have a few, feet until the property line and your neighbor's house. So what Greg's done is he basically, right on the property line, literally, he built a fence, a wire fence, and he basically grows up the grapes with that, if you guys could see that there. And then right next to it, he has a beautiful peach tree next to it. Another thing Greg always encourages you guys to do in most cases, but not all, is to keep your trees pruned low. This way you can have them bush out, but more importantly, you're able to easily harvest the fruit without breaking your neck by climbing a ladder. And it also can be more productive for you if you're keeping it tight and compact. So in this area of his front yard, which is basically just right behind the hedge of the citrus, he has converted part of it to just have a standard garden bed. And he's got a lot of tomatoes planted fairly recently. It is March here in Phoenix, and today's a nice 72 degrees. I'm actually in a nice t-shirt there. And he has lots of different tomatoes planted. Now, one of the things, especially living in Phoenix, you have to conserve your water. This part of his garden is not flood irrigated because it might wash all the soil away and not be good for some of the plants, because some of the flood water, may not be the entirely cleanest for vegetables that you will be eating. So actually he uses drip tape. So whether you want to use some kind of a drip emitters, drip tubing, or drip tape, I would encourage you guys to reduce your water use by using drip tape, which is excellent for the outdoor garden, especially with all the evaporation here. He also is using some cardboard and other, mulch on the top to prevent the moisture loss. So Greg is what I would call a lazy gardener. Actually, he's self-confessed as a lazy gardener, so I don't even have to call him that myself. So I'm not calling him that. He proclaims that himself. And here's the thing, right? Don't think that you gotta like be out in your garden every single day to pull every single weed or to harvest all the seeds or harvest your crops before they go to seed, right? Nature works, nature knows what to do. And even if you don't make it out there to harvest your kale plants before they go to seed, right? They'll send up the shoots, they'll send up flowers, they'll create seeds, they'll create flowers for the bees so they can eat, and they'll go to seed, and he'll basically just let the seeds grow. And then he's so lazy sometimes, he doesn't even collect the seeds. So the seeds pods pop open, the seeds fall, and then they grow on their own the following season. So actually, there's not one parsley plant in this garden that he has planted for the last 5 years. You know, there's not one carrot that he's planted probably in the last 5 years. A lot of these plants are actually just volunteer plants so that he will always have a continual cycle of food without him literally doing anything, but maybe, you know, keeping some good soil and keeping it watered. But the plants will basically grow on their own, you know. So this morning he had, you know, some greens and eggs from his chickens in the back for breakfast. So, you know, even if you're a lazy gardener, you could still eat something out of your garden every single day. So pretty much his front yard is the area that gets most of the sun, you know, so that's where he's growing most of his veggies that generally like more sun. Now we're going to venture off to the backyard of the urban farm to see what he's got growing on back there. He's got some chickens and he's done some really cool things with his chicken coop I want to share with you guys. He has a new growing system made by somebody locally that I've never seen before in my life, and I think it is even much smarter than having a SIP or self-irrigated planter beds. In addition, he's growing different kinds of trees and pruning them differently so you guys can see the results and learn more about some valuable trees that you guys should grow here in Phoenix. And of course, we will learn his favorite trees to grow here in Phoenix for the delicious fruit. So let's head on back. So this is the urban farm backyard, a little bit more shady back here for sure. And he has more citrus kind of growing as a hedge. So it's actually nice as you walk in, you get the nice citrus scent. It reminds me of being in like California or Florida, but we are here in Arizona, another, you know, popular citrus state. And his house is right there. So he planted a mulberry tree right there, and they are fast growing, especially in the summertime, that he basically hacked back so it's no taller than his house. It is putting on lots of Pakistani mulberry, which are my favorite kind that aren't quite yet in season. I should have waited about a month to come, then I would be, my face would be all purple right now. But basically he hacks it back and is growing it nice and wide so that it covers his house, because what will happen is these will fruit all early in the spring slash summer, and then it'll just massively grow out with the leaf growth that then will cover his wall, and then it will keep his house cooler in the summertime. So he tries to use the, you know, the shade that the plants create in specific methods to benefit him, which I always want to remind you guys to do. If you could think of a way that the shade would benefit you, your house, the cooling, especially if you live somewhere hot, or more importantly, cooling for your animals, or providing them a different microclimate, or even providing plants a microclimate underneath them, because, you know, big trees will shade out smaller plants. So Greg's a guy that will always preach to you guys to keep your fruit tree short. I mean, every year he sells a bunch of fruit trees. You could learn more about that on his website, urbanfarm.org, for his yearly fruit tree sale, where he brings in fruit trees for people in the Phoenix area, probably at a really good price, and he passes the savings on to you guys. But he tells you guys to keep them short, but he's not even doing what he says with this apple tree right there. I mean, he's actually purposely left it a little bit taller than he would normally do it. And once again, that is for shade, because in the summertime, as the sun goes down to the house on that side, the sun basically blares in to the back of his house. So he grew this really tall so that the sun will not blare into his house in the summer, which would heat his house up more, which then he would have to use more air conditioning to cool it down. Of course, his air conditioning, though, is offset by the solar panels on top of his roof. Another smart thing to do. So since I was here last time, a few things Greg is now doing is that he basically has this movable fence. So now he will allow the chickens to roam out of their little pen and, you know, a free roam in part of his lawn area or his grass, so that they can basically dig up bugs, they can create fertilizer for his plants, and then he'll basically rotate where the fence goes so that he rotates where the chickens go. So basically he does not have to literally move their poop out of certain places, but the chickens are pooping where they need to. Plus they're, you know, digging up the soil, aerating it, and all this kind of stuff. The reason for the shot though is because I want to show you guys those two trees. They're kind of tall. Maybe if you see the power lines right behind it, they're actually quite tall. These are one of Greg's favorite new trees. It's called a dwarf black mulberry. And these black mulberries are like little small fruits. And these guys, he's grown them tall. Regular mulberries could get a lot taller, but this is a dwarf. And I think that's about maybe 3 or 4 years old from what he told me. But the other cool thing that I saw here and what he's doing is, while you can grow them tall, he did this just to show, he would actually recommend you guys grow them like he is right on the other side. So I'm going to pivot the camera around and show you guys what it looks like and how I think a better way to grow mulberries is. All right, so there's a better way to grow mulberries, in my personal opinion, is as a hedge. So isn't there like a famous nursery rhyme running around the mulberry bush? They don't say running around the mulberry tree, they say bush, right? Well, yeah, a hedge is like a bush. You keep it small, so these were growing tall, and he progressively hacked some back so they don't get too much taller than 6 feet. That way you could easily harvest all little small black berries on it, which actually, the harvest period window for this variety here in Phoenix is probably about between like end of March, April, to all the way through June. So you got a couple good months of those small little black dwarf mulberries. So Greg, I think, is a fairly intelligent guy, and this is something I think all you guys should also do in your yard. I mean, every place of Greg's yard has like a different theme. Like his front yard is his vegetables, backyard mostly fruit trees with other edibles and non-edibles planted in there. Most of the fruit trees in the backyard, aside from that apple tree, are actually kept small. Likewise with these ones back in this area. Now this area is interesting because this is more of a quote-unquote wild area. He has it fenced off so that the chickens can't get back in there and destroy it. But this basically is a wildlife habitat. I want you guys to have a wildlife habitat that you don't disturb, that you don't get into, that the birds and the bees and the other earthlings and other earth creatures that live on the planet can nest, can live, can have a home that is not disturbed. So you can see this area is just literally pretty much wild. He planted a few fruit trees that are kind of growing tall, but everything down below are just basically wild and native plants that he just lets grow to attract the beneficial insects and other local wildlife, which I think is definitely important to have in your yard. Many big farms will actually have like riparian zones where they have borders, you know, around their farm of natural areas such as this. And I think that's probably the best way to do it, is around your place. But hey, at least minimal dedicate a space in your backyard or even your front yard for, some more native crops and wild plants to grow that you don't really, touch. Another thing Greg does rather well is CYG. Cover your ground. This is a very important principle to cover your ground so that you could build the soil microbiome, right? He covers it by using things like wood chips and mulch, right? Things like his freshly made compost that we'll be showing you guys in a little bit. But more importantly, you can grow ground cover plants. Even better than just growing ground cover plants, you could grow ground cover edible plants. So some of the plants he uses just to cover the ground, he could grow mint in a whole area, and it, trust me, it will take over a whole area. It will cover your ground and also provide a lot of mint, but you got to watch out because it can take over as well. Another plant that he grows to cover the ground right here are nasturtiums. I love covering the ground more so with nasturtiums than mint because they will not necessarily start sending out runners and take over, although they will be prolific, you know, during the cool times of the year. They will grow. You got all the nice flowers that are completely edible. Let me go ahead and pull one of these guys off. And they have some really cool colors as well. I think they got some kind of Alaskan varieties that are really deep colors. But yeah, these flowers are quite edible. It's been a while since I've had a nasturtium flower. They're actually quite good. Actually, those are quite good, actually. I feel a nice fruity flavor, but then you got a nice kick of like a hot pepper bite. Like a mustard green bite, but it's not that much. Now, the other thing people don't know is that all these leaves are edible in a salad. Now, they are hotter than the flowers. You can literally pop off some of these leaves and use them as wrappers. Like if you're gonna make dolmas, right? Or put little like nut pates and cut up vegetables or salsa and guacamole, and then basically roll them up, right? You could roll the sides up too. You could use these as little food wrappers, you know, as your frou-frou, you know, hors d'oeuvres for your guests, and even serve them like this, but don't pick them up like this because everything will fall open. But these are also completely edible. You know, I would grow a bunch of lettuce and then harvest some lettuce and then harvest like, you know, a handful of these and add them to your salad. I don't know that I would necessarily make a whole salad out of these, especially if you're not used to it. They have a little bit of mucilaginous, and then you get a little bit of that like peppery kind of bite. I kind of like them. And I encourage you guys to eat them. I want you guys to increase your food repertoire and the different foods you grow in your garden. for diversity of the microbiome, for your soil, but more importantly for you. When you grow different foods, you will eat different foods, and it's very important for our bodies to eat a wide range of foods, because every different food we eat has different fibers, phytonutrients, vitamins, and minerals that then will feed our bodies, but more importantly, our microbiome. Nasturtium leaves, they're good. So the coolest thing that I've learned this trip to Greg's, I mean, of course, hanging out with them, because I haven't hung out with them for like 5 years or been in much contact, but the coolest thing is what he has going on right here. It's basically a raised bed, raised up on stilts. Now, you don't have to have it that high. He built it against actually the fence, but it's actually supported on by four legs, and it's basically a self-irrigating planter, but it's not a standard sip bed, right? I'm familiar with sip beds. Post a link down below to a video I made, you know, why you should grow a sip bed instead of a, which is basically a self-watering raised bed instead of a standard raised bed where you basically just keep dumping water in. My friends in Mesquite, Nevada, grow in a sip bed, and it works wonderfully for them, allows them to save water and even have a better time at growing. But for some reasons, I actually don't like a sip bed because you actually have constant water always in the bottom. And I'm not really a fan of having always constant water in the bottom of a growing pot. It may be constricting, and in my opinion, it's not entirely natural in most cases. Whereas this bed, which is called a LEAR bed, I think it stands for L-E-A-R, like King Lear, and there's some kind of acronym it means, and I don't know what it is. Basically, it's a bed that is elevated, could be as high as you want it, and it has a tank, so there's a stock tank over there filled with water. And what happens is the water pumps out of the stock tank and fills up one side of the bed, and it just comes on for like, I don't know, 7 minutes, and then the water will flow because it's actually at a little bit of an angle, not a lot, and the water basically just flows through the whole soil in the bed, gets it completely drenched. It also wicks up at that time, and then it flows out to the other side where it's minimally filtered and then goes back into the stock tank where it can then rest and get rewatered later. Most times of the year, Greg waters this once, and in the middle of the summer when it's really hot, he might do it two times a day to make sure his plants survive. And as it looks, he has some amazing Swiss chard growing in there. I'm gonna go ahead and better explain how this system works in case you wanna make one. All right, so now I'm gonna try to explain to you guys how this works. This is basically like a raised bed. I don't know, I'd say it's maybe like 3 feet wide. You could probably do 4 feet wide. And it's probably about a foot deep or so. And basically it's a bed made out of plywood, and they basically line the inside with a, you know, pond liner. If you're really cheap, you could use plastic, but make sure you get the UV resistant plastic, otherwise it's gonna degrade really fast and then you got to rip everything apart. So just get the right stuff the first time. They use a pond liner to line the whole bottom. So basically it's a waterproof enclosure. It'd be interesting, you could do this out of an IBC tote or maybe even like one of those kids' swimming pools, which would be kind of interesting as well. Basically what they did was they got some the wire mesh stuff, kind of like, it's not like the chicken wire with big holes. I forget. Oh, it's hardware cloth with like a small size, maybe quarter inch spacing. And they basically, on the end, they basically built a wall and they wrap it around, and it probably goes underneath the bottom too. So what happens is the pump comes on, the water comes out right there. It basically fills up this side, which is open. And for me personally, I don't know that I'd make it this big. I'd make it probably less space. You don't need this much. You're losing growing space. It would then fill up, and then what happens is once it fills up and the pump goes on for 7 minutes, it turns off. There's still standing water because Greg had turned the pump on to show me. The water then sits in the bottom, fills up, and then basically the water line is consistent, you know, here tall, and then as it kind of slants down, it kind of like sinks down. So this area will get a bit more water than near the end. And actually, I don't know if this is intentionally designed, but the soil here is sloped. It goes from high a little bit lower, so I don't know if this is by design or if it's supposed to be all layered up. The cool thing is it comes on every day, and if we take a little trowel thing here, we could scoop back, and this soil is really, really moist, you know. And I'm seeing some worms in here as well. You know, the worms love this because it's not constant water. They have, it's dry and wet cycles, which I think are very important for some plants. And in addition, when they set this up originally, they didn't put rocks down on the bottom. They basically put some like wood chips. So the wood chips over time will rot down, create a nice bacterial surface area or fungal surface area, and feed the beneficial fungus and microbes and everything down there, and really make a rich system. You can see here he's got some really nice Swiss chard, some more baby stuff, and then some more adult stuff in the back. I want to go ahead and take you guys now to the other side and show you guys how that looks. So as you guys can see, this is the other end, and basically they got the same hardware cloth here, quarter inch spacing. It is kind of leaning and bowing a little bit. Maybe they could have enforced this better. Maybe you could use some kind of a better framing system instead of just a hardware cloth. Maybe put like some kind of utility paneling to kind of hold the hardware cloth in place so it doesn't like bow like this. They have another open area on the end, so it goes to soil to here, then they got the hardware cloth, and they just have an open area for the drain. Once again, I wouldn't put this much drain space. I'd probably make the drain less. And they have basically like a big net pot upside down to kind of catch so that the large leaves and debris don't go through. And then this basically just drains down free flowing. There's no kind of float valve or anything in there like you would use in an aquaponic system to just drain through, and then it drains back into the stock tank. And he's been using this for years now, and it works really good. He also is introducing me to the guy that makes these. So at some point in the future, I hope to get over there and really cover this design and learn more about the madman that made this. I mean, I think it's actually quite intelligent. No, the other thing I mentioned, over on this side, they have some of the landscape fabric that they use to keep weed block out, because as the water is flowing down this side, you want it free flowing on that side. But on this side, because the gravity will bring the water this way, it'll also bring more particulate into this water. So they're trying to prevent that with some weed cloth that is put directly against the hardware cloth. Okay. And then finally, everything drains down into the stock tank, and it has a sump pump that comes on a timer that I will now show you. So as you guys can see, here's just a standard, galvanized metal stock tank. You could use like a 55-gallon drum that's cut off, but he wants to have a, you know, good volume of water. He has a sump pump in there, basically with piped up PVC piping that just jets out to the other side. If you're super lazy, you could use like the black irrigation tubing, which is how I set up mine at home for my flood table. That pretty much works on a similar principle, but everything is actually in pots. And then he has just a little plug-in dumb timer right there that he could program for the right amount of minutes. Now, I personally would recommend, instead of a digital one, you know, the one with the little clicker tabs, but they're not as programmable. I found the ones that are digital, they might lose the program, and then you could be screwed unless you get a good one that has like some kind of battery backup. But the one with the clicker tabs that you click up and down, I think I have a 15-minute cycle, whereas those ones could go like by the minute or even sometimes by the second. I think this is a fine system and a fine setup. I want to look into more of this. You know, I do want to convert part of my backyard to some kind of different growing setup instead of just the standard raised beds where I'm just watering through, and then it ends up going back, you know, into the soil to feed the aquifer. I'd rather, you know, reuse the water and be more efficient at it. I mean, other things he does to conserve water here is he collects rainwater off the roof. He also has an outdoor shower to, use the water after he takes a shower to go back into his garden as well, which I think is all amazing. And I would encourage you guys to have other low water usage, fixtures such as toilets and shower heads and faucets in your house as well. So while we're talking about all these things in conservation, another big thing that is important to Greg is building your soil, especially here in Phoenix, where you have basically sand. It's not really soil, and you need to build organic matter. Compost could get expensive, plus a lot of the bag compost at your big box store like Home Depot or Lowe's, I would consider more like mulch instead of true compost. So another thing he does is actually makes his own compost here, not only with his food scraps and yard clippings, but also he gets it from a local restaurant as well. So he's diverting food from the waste stream, and more importantly, getting free buckets to use at the same time. So let's learn more about how he does that. One of the cool things Greg does here that is really awesome, and I would encourage you guys to do, is create partnerships with your local community. So there's a restaurant in the area that basically will throw away their food scraps every single week. And instead of throwing them out and then going to the landfill and not doing anything for anybody or the planet, Greg offers to take them. And the cool thing is, how he takes them is quite unique. So the restaurant also, you know, basically empties these kosher dill pickle spears buckets, because they probably put dill pickles on every different dish that goes out of the kitchen. They have all these buckets. So he just has the restaurant as they empty the buckets, fill them up with their waste vegetable materials, and then give it to him. So he gets like a dozen buckets a week or something like that. And if we take a look at one of these buckets inside here, we could open it up and we can see what he's getting inside. So let's take a look. Inside here, it looks like we got a lot of lettuce that's rotten. And to me, they don't even like rinse out the dill pickle buckets that well. And that's probably a good thing, because there's probably lactobacillus in there that's already pre-fermenting some of the stuff he's getting before he even dumps it on his compost pile. Another thing you guys might want to do is, once you get each bucket, maybe sprinkle a little bit of bokashi in there, and that'll kind of help, some of the breakdown of the materials before you have time to put it on your compost pile. So the cool thing is, because he gets so many buckets every week, I'm gonna get to take a few home, because I'm bucket deficient. I use buckets for collecting old leaves, cutting materials up, storing compost that I've pre-mixed that's ready to get topped off on my beds when I make big batches. There is a multiple use of buckets I would have you and encourage you guys even to stand on or sit on in my garden. I would encourage you to check a video that I made down below many years ago about the many uses of a 5-gallon bucket. It was back in the day, and it was actually quite a fun video to make. You know, I would encourage you guys actually not to throw out your buckets. These are actually food grade buckets too, if they're coming from a restaurant, which can be even more valuable for food storage or whatever you want to do with them. Yeah, so check with local restaurants in your area and see if you can get them to divert some of their food waste so that you can create more organic matter in your backyard. So Greg previously had like a pallet system where he set up pallets and he would just compost in the pallets. Instead, he's gone to a better system in my view, which is basically he's got just this, fencing wire stuff, like the hardware cloth with a big, maybe 2x3 opening, galvanized, nice and durable. He basically just forms it into a big circle, and all he does, he just layers up all his material. So he layers up, some of the carbon materials, such as leaves from his yard, leaves from his neighbor's yard, leaves that he collects from other places. He has another property that he gets leaves from, and or things like straw, and he'll put straw on there, and then he'll put a layer of the food scraps and his yard waste, and then layer it up. And he'll just keep building layers, layer after layer, until it's full. And you know, by that time, it's several months have gone by. When it gets nice and tall and has been sitting there a while, then he will take this off and then start a new pile next to it, right? Meanwhile, this is in his chicken area. So if you see some little chickens scurrying around, right? They're hanging out all by the compost because they know bugs and worms and creatures like to live in the compost. And what are bugs for chickens? Their food. It's probably their chicken's favorite food. They'd rather eat bugs and worms and snails than actually grass and leaves and trees and fruits and whatever else they eat, right? So they're digging around in here, and when this is all done, he basically opens this up, he leaves it as a pile, and then basically the chickens get in there and they flatten it. They eat all the little bugs and creatures in there that have made the compost for Greg. But then he feeds the chickens some really amazing sources of protein, all the insects, and then furthermore, the chickens will poop in there and create even better compost that then, once they've gone through it, then he will basically harvest it up out of here and then add it to his different fruit trees, add it to his vegetable garden, and add it all over his yard to increase the organic matter and increase fertility. I think this is an excellent method. Most places, always could use some organic matter. In general, organic matter, adding organic matter is not going to be hurtful or harmful. So I'd encourage you guys to get as much organic matter as you can. A really easy place to do it, and because the organic matter is already broken up, we can compost faster, would be things like juice bars. Juice bars throw out amazingly large quantities of pulp and fiber, which are perfect to compost down and will compost quicker than whole big heads of lettuce, although it is already starting to, ferment when he gets them, which are already partially broken down as well. Composting is probably one of the most important things that every gardener should do. Now, because we are in Phoenix and it is quite an arid climate here, which means dry, liquid and water is sucked out of this pile. So sometimes you will also water it as necessary to keep the proper moisture level. If you just try to do a pile and have an open pile here in Phoenix or even someplace like Las Vegas, it would just basically, the water would evaporate out of it and then no bacterial life or fungi would grow in there in a dry conditions. This is why I prefer, instead of having an open pile, I use compost tumblers, which presents its own sets of pros and cons. But that's what I'm using right now as my solution to get rid of my food scraps. I'm not taking on anybody else's food scraps though at present time. I generate enough for like a 5-gallon bucket every day or two myself. This part of the video is called Create Your Own Shade and Even Yet an Easier Way to Harvest Your Fruits. Okay, so what happened was he has chickens and I'm in the chicken coop literally right now. It's a big fenced off area. But what happened previously is it wasn't fenced off and a coyote got in here and killed all his chickens he had, I don't know, 6 years ago or something, a bunch of years ago. Then he's like, I need to basically cover the chicken coop so that the coyotes can't get in there. So he did that, and we have a roof on here, once again, with his favorite galvanized hardware cloth, you know, maybe like a 2-inch by 1-inch, you know, opening. The sides have a closer weave, maybe a 1/2 inch or something like that. But the problem was that there's this nice huge, and it's a pretty good big girth on it, or caliper, mulberry tree. So what did he do? He basically hacked back the mulberry tree so that it would fit underneath his structure. Meanwhile, the mulberry's like, I got hacked back, I just got pruned to heck. So then it actually started regrowing, and because the branches can't grow above the hardware cloth or through it, any large branches for any easy amount of time, it's basically grown underneath the branches, so the branches are actually being kept down by the framing of the, you know, 2x4s and the hardware cloth, so that all this is basically espalier one level underneath here. So you guys can see clearly that I have all these mulberries that are just hanging that, once again, I wish was a little bit later in the time because we have just mulberries and mulberries. The other thing this did was that this created a lot of shade. Shade is very required in the summertime, especially for the chickens, because it gets really hot, and this area of his yard was previously unshaded. Now, you could put some shade cloth up, but better than shade cloth is living shade. The leaves are actually utilizing the sun's energy to give it to the tree, to feed the soil microbiome, to send down root exudates, to grow more leaves, to grow more fruit, and to have the tree prosper. So I'd rather have you guys grow greenery instead of simply putting a tarp up, and this is definitely one excellent way to do that. I just wish I was here a month later. I think I did cover this in my previous episode when I was at Greg's, but it had definitely not filled out this much. I mean, he's got it. I mean, this chicken coop is probably like a 12 feet, 15 feet across, and this mulberry is basically just jetting out everywhere. You know, it'd just be the nicest thing, because my mulberry tree, I did not prune. It's really tall. I got to hop up on my roof to harvest some of the fruits. This makes it super easy to find the right mulberries and harvest them, whether you want to make a chicken coop or just contain your trees to keep them low and slow so that you can harvest your fruits. All right, the next thing I want to do for you guys, actually, we're going to go ahead and interview the expert, Greg Peterson, and he's going to share with you guys some of his gardening and growing and farming tips, as well as what he has been up to and how he can help educate you about growing food online. So now I have the pleasure of interviewing for you guys Greg Peterson, and this is his amazing property. And the cool thing about Greg is that he's been doing this longer than almost I've been alive, but actually not quite. He bought this place like 32 years ago and has been gardening on the property ever since, in, you know, big ways and small ways, and he's always changing and doing new stuff, and he's learning new stuff, and when I visit him, I'm learning new stuff, and you guys are learning new stuff too. So hopefully this interview will be a wealth of knowledge. So Greg, I want to ask a couple questions. The first question is, why did you start growing food at your house when everybody else in the neighborhood has like a lawn, and maybe people have like fruit trees in their backyard, but nobody puts a garden in their front yard to grow vegetables?
Right. Well, this is a long time thing for me. I wrote a paper in the 8th grade on how we were overfishing oceans. That was in the mid-70s. And so I've had this notion that there's something wrong with the way we're eating on the planet for a very long time. And when I look at my yard, it doesn't make sense to me to plant things you can't eat. So, you know, everything in the yard you can eat, or it supports edibles. You know, so like this big ash tree back behind us, it dumps a bunch of leaves every fall that turn into compost for me. So this is a lifelong journey for me.
That's amazing. Yeah, I mean, he was talking about overfishing the oceans when he was 8. I want you guys to check out, if you guys have Netflix, the new movie that just got released a couple days ago is called Seaspiracy, all about that kind of stuff. So anyways, Greg, moving on is, you grow lots of different things, and I mean, there's so many things we could talk about today, but I want to just kind of drill down to some of the basics, some of the most important things I know you're passionate about, as I am, is the soil health.
Soil health.
We gotta build the soil health, and especially here in Phoenix, the probably number one way to do that is by adding organic matter and composting. I showed them how you are composting now and getting free resources
big
from
time.
Local restaurants, but I want you to share the story with me. How did you come across that arrangement to get free, literally, compost material so you can make the best compost right here in your backyard instead of having to buy it?
Thanks. So there's this restaurant here in town called the Duck and Decanter, and I've actually been eating at that restaurant almost as long as I've been alive. So they've been open since the mid-70s, and I started eating there in the mid-70s, and so they've become my friends. I went to high school with them, and I was talking with the owner one day, and she said to me, Greg, I've got 10 buckets a week of food waste. What do I do with it? Oh, and by the way, they come with food grade buckets. So I get about 500 food grade buckets a week. A year.
Yeah,
a year. 10 a week, 500 a year. And so we do all kinds of great things. I've made raised planters out of the buckets. We use them as Homer buckets at our fruit tree program. So it gives us a good steady supply. And the really cool thing about this process, I've been doing it for about 3 years now. I now make enough compost on site here at the urban farm that I don't have to buy any.
Wow.
That's pretty
cool.
Saves
a lot of money.
Yeah.
Compost saves. Ain't cheap.
Right.
And it's hard to get good compost. It's hard to really get good compost.
Well, you want it to be alive.
Yep.
So the compost needs to be alive. So it needs to be in process or soon after you get it, it need to have been in process. And it just turns. It's really cool. I have three neighbors that bring me leaves every fall. So then I have plenty of browns to add with the greens in. So yeah, it's
a cool process. But how long did it take to fill up one of those, wire mesh mm-hmm. things you do? And why did you convert to the wire mesh from your bin system that you were using previously?
So, great question. So the problem with the bin system is that we use pallets. And pallets are heat treated, they're chemical treated for pesticides and not to burn. So that's putting chemicals into my compost. That's why I went to the metal. And it takes me a good 4 to 5 months to fill up the metal piece. And then I let it sit there for 4 to 5 months. So this is it's not a short process. This is a 8 to 9 month process of working through getting the food and the leaves to break down so that I can put it in my garden. And then the cool thing is what I do is I just unlatch the metal fencing and it spreads out all over the place and the chickens go in and they eat any bugs and anything that's growing in there and they add their manure to it. And then I just scoop it up and I add it to 2 inches to the top of my garden once a year.
That's simply amazing. You know, I mean, Greg's been doing this a long time. He knows his stuff. And here's the thing I know from traveling around and seeing how different composts are made. You actually want to have a long-term compost. You don't want to have a quick-turn compost. It's quite unfortunate that yard waste facilities will get the material in. They'll put it in windrows. They'll turn it. And literally, like, within a couple months, they're sending it back out. And it's mostly as mulch, not a fully digested or degraded compost. Surely chickens are not going through that stuff, you know? And so the quality is definitely not as good as stuff you could make. And, you know, you don't even turn it, right?
No, I don't even turn it. I just add the stuff to the round, just add it to the top. The chickens do the turning for us.
Excellent. Yeah, and once again, slow compost. You don't want to disturb the microbes. The more you disturb the microbes, the more you're upsetting them. You will disturb the different balance. You'll be selecting for certain microbes that like to be turned and aerated, but you're going to lose other ones, especially the most important ones like the fungi, that do not like to be disturbed. That's why I think long piles are way more important. It's easy to get bacterial-based compost, at the Home Depot, which, number one, Greg mentioned earlier, but I want to highlight, it's in a bag. Has it been sitting in that bag in the Home Depot in my town? It's probably been sitting there at least 6 months because people do not garden. They don't farm. I can see the bags degrading in the sun. And it's like, that's the compost you do not want because it's not active, not alive. The reason for compost is not just the organic matter. It's all the living soil microbiota, the bacteria, the fungi, and the fungirls, and whatever else is in there that I don't even know the names of, arthropods and all these creatures and stuff. right? So, Greg, I know composting and building soil is very important to you.
Yeah.
So aside from your compost, I mean, compost is one element of the soil, but I know there's so many others. So you want to enlighten some of my viewers about, you know, some of the other important elements of building healthy soil so that you can have healthy plants and healthy trees?
Yeah. So number one, buy local compost. Local compost has local biology in it. Number one. So fixing broken dirt, fixing a garden, starting your garden, what you need to do is you need to add organic matter because there's five components of healthy soil. Dirt is one of them. And here in the desert of Phoenix, we have plenty of dirt. It's broken down rock. It's got micronutrients in it. But if that's all you have, good luck. You're not going to get very far with it. So the five components of healthy soil are dirt, airspace, organic matter, everything that's alive in the soil, and water. And the fix for it, this is the really cool part. Just add organic matter. You can add mulch around your fruit trees. You can add 2 to 4 inches of planting mix or compost on top of your garden beds. And that starts the process of building really healthy soil.
Wow, man, you broke it down like nobody else ever has for
Nice.
To make it super simple and super easy. Five simple components, guys. And I mean, these are the basics, but I know you teach actually online more about how to even dial it in, even get better, right? So you have a website for that you want to share with my viewers so you guys can sign up right now, get your name on there and get the series so you can learn how to build your soil very easily from Greg, the expert himself.
Well, thank you. It's healthysoilhacked.com. Healthysoilhacked.com. There's videos there and content on how to create healthy soil.
Yeah, I mean, above all else, before you even figure out what to plant, you want to build healthy soil. The healthier soil, the more successful you'll be. I mean, I see people, I get emails all the time, like I see comments like, John, I got compost from Home Depot. I put it in a pot and I tried to grow plants and they died. They're turning yellow. The soil is not healthy. You need to make your own soil. You can't expect somebody else to do it for you when you're buying compost in a bag and you're being cheap and you're getting the stuff for $2 a bag, which is like not good, right? And it's hard to find good, healthy soil near you. So that's why you got to compost it, like make your own. Even before you even start gardening, right? It'd be even smart to just partner with restaurants like Greg has to bring in and make compost for a couple years before you even start gardening. I mean, you should start gardening immediately and growing your food now. But the soil is so critical to your optimal success. So Greg, I think another thing I want to talk to you about today, aside from the soil, is that your LEAR system. So
oh, yes.
I want to know more about the LEAR system, because I mean, of all the things I visited and all the projects you have, I mean, I really like the mulberry, you know, bushes and stuff and the new variety. But I really like the LEAR system because that's something I literally haven't seen before in all my travels. Mm-hmm. And trust me, I get around.
Oh, yes, you do. So the LEAR garden, Ed Williams, he's a local engineer here in town. He figured out how to take woody mulch and add a little bit of healthy soil on top of it. And the fungi shows up and the mycorrhiza and everything shows up, breaks it down and turns it into soil in this raised bed garden, essentially. And it's like a aquaponic system, but it's got soil in it. And you know that healthy soil has microbiology in it that makes healthier plants. So what Ed's done is he's turned this concept of an aquaponic system into a soil aquaponic system. And he claims, and this is what we're starting to see, it makes soil at an amazing rate. It makes healthy soil at an amazing rate. And one of the things that I get a lot of emails, I'm sure you know, yeah. Right? People are asking me often, they'll say to me like, I got mushrooms growing in my yard. How do I kill them? It's like, no. If you got mushrooms growing in your yard, you're doing something right. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. A fungi.
Yeah. Yeah.
Creating the net, the webs and the networks down below the ground because the fruiting bodies are just what you're seeing above.
Yeah. And that's the cool thing about the LEAR garden is that it's designed to build that biology and to build mushrooms growing in the space to create healthy soil.
Wow. So I wonder if the engineer could engineer some way that mushroom grew out the side, got vegetables inside, then you got a full dinner right there, mushrooms and leaves.
Right.
All right, Greg. So since you've been living here in Phoenix, and I would consider you an expert gardener for Phoenix, since you know you have so much experience and educated yourself and all this kind of stuff, I want you to share three top tips for growing vegetables in Phoenix. I know a lot of people, usually I see people growing food in Phoenix, it's fruit trees. Mm-hmm. I really want you to dump some vegetable gardening growing experience for people in Phoenix or wherever they live, because I mean, these tips will work anywhere, literally.
Mostly.
Yeah, mostly.
All right, cool. So number one, we already talked about it, grow healthy soil. The healthier your soil, the healthier the plants. And the thing is, the tastier the plants, and the bugs will stay away from them more if you have healthy plants. So it's this whole circular system. So number one, build healthy soil. Number two, for the desert, you want to grow in a space that is a microclimate that's going to nurture your plants. And here in the desert, a western exposure, which gets sun from noon until sundown, is probably going to be the hardest place to grow. An eastern exposure, which gets sun from sun up until noon, is probably going to be your easiest place to grow. Unless, of course, you want to grow in the wintertime, then a western exposure might be great for you. So it's, you kind of got to sit with it. And this gets to my point number three. And the permaculture, I like to call permaculture the art and science of working with nature. How do we plug in with nature, work in the flow of nature rather than against nature? Permaculture is something I've studied for over 30 years, and it's looking at natural systems and how natural systems work. And the first thing that you do when you're looking at a landscape is you observe. And I tell people to spend at least a year observing on your property before you make any major changes. Now you can still put a garden in. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about making major changes. So what you're looking for is you're looking for, where's the shade at? Where's the sun at? Where's the warmer spaces in your property? Where's the cooler spaces in your property? Where does the rain fall when it comes off of your roof? How can you make use of that? So you're looking for water, for heat, for just where is the best place to grow on your property. So number three for me is observation.
Wise words. I mean, just a recent video that I made with a friend, Josh from Boogie Brew, observation and observing nature. And then he had, you know, observing the patterns of nature.
Yeah.
So I mean, these go directly hand in hand. I mean, these are like expert topic tips, because most gardeners will just say, oh, just plant some stuff.
Right.
No, you got to set up the systems properly if you want to succeed, you know, in the long term. Yeah, maybe short term, you know, you're fine, but the long term is critical. And actually, that gets me to the next topic, is fruit trees. Fruit trees are long term investments. And I know you're really integrated into the fruit tree culture here.
Yes.
In Phoenix, by even providing fruit trees for, you know, some of the lowest prices direct to people, cutting out the major nursery middleman, you know, so you could get more people growing fruit here in Phoenix. Do you want to share more about that program you got going?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks. So fruittrees.org is our website for that. And what we have is, we have an education program. I've been growing fruit trees here in the Valley for 45 years. I've been really studying fruit trees in the desert for about 30 years. And 22 years ago, I started teaching about it. And through the Urban Farm Fruit Tree Program, we've created a series of things that you can do that improves your success, from planting to shading the trees and all of that. Plus, the only trees that we bring in are the simple trees. I'm a big fan of being a lazy gardener. I want to put something in the ground. This is an apple tree we're sitting underneath. I want to put it in the ground and walk away from it. And the nice thing about this tree has been in the ground for about 10 years, and it produces about 300 pounds of apples every year. And there's not much for me to do with it. In the winter, I prune it up a little bit, and I foliar feed periodically, and it produces food year after year after year. In this lifespan, so I've planted trees in the desert long enough to know how long they live. So there's a couple of citrus trees back here on the back side of my property that were planted in the 1920s.
Wow, so 100 years old.
100 years old.
Wow.
So citrus trees will live a long time in the heat. The deciduous trees, the apples, peaches, apricots, plums, pears, those kinds of things, they don't live so long. If you get 25 or 30 years out of them, you're doing really good. Once you plant a tree, It takes about 3 to 5 years for it to hit its stride. And if I get, let's just say I get 200 pounds of apples off of this tree every year for 20 years.
Wow.
That's over a ton of apples. I'm not doing the math quickly enough in my head. That's a lot of apples.
That's a lot of apples.
For one time. You know, you plant it right the first time and you do a little bit of fertilizing, a little bit of foliar feeding, and then you harvest the food every year.
And you get the right variety of apple for the desert.
And you get the and you get the right variety, because there's so many considerations. There's chill hours, there's rootstock, there's when does it ripen. You have to make sure that you're getting the right variety for your area.
Yeah, and you can't depend on nurseries to do that. So that's why I love what you do. You bring in the exact right kinds that people need here in Phoenix that you have direct experience with, that you know will be successful because you've tried them over the many years.
Yeah, I've proven all of the varieties that we bring in. I've proven that they make dozens to hundreds of pounds of fruit. It's so cool.
That's amazing. Yeah, I mean, fruit trees are one of the best investments. I mean, you buy a fruit tree once, and then a couple years later, you got 200 pounds of apples a year. I buy a case of apples for like $40. That's like one, and then I use them, they're gone. Buy a fruit tree, guys. Best investment you can make. That's why you should grow your food too. So getting back to vegetables, Greg, because as much as I love eating fruit, I'm gonna eat some jackfruit later today.
Nice.
Is let's talk about some vegetables. So what are some good vegetables to grow in the summertime in Phoenix?
There we go.
I'm trying to stump you here, and I'm trying to learn myself.
Right? So the greens pretty much go away in the summertime. Although kale is really hardy, and the dino kale seems to produce all year round, which is cool. And I have some dino kale in the front yard that's probably 2 years old.
Wow.
Yeah. And it just keeps producing and keeps producing. So what do you plant in the spring and summer? Melons, squash, any of the vining crops, cucumbers, they do really well. Loofah, you can actually eat loofah when they're small. Loofah thrives here. If you plant some loofah seeds, it will make so much for you. It's amazing. If you get tomatoes in early, the tomatoes will produce well into June. Peppers, eggplants, okra if you like it. Those kinds of things are what we plant this time of year. And there's so many varieties of them.
Yeah. Yeah, I've had really good luck with the okra and the heat. Okra loves the heat.
Okra loves the heat.
Plants love the heat.
Yep.
And of course, there's other leafy greens you could grow. They're a bit more like Asian, so they're not quite as common as the standard leafy greens that you could grow. So like Egyptian spinach is related to the okra.
Yep.
Same family, and that really does well. The Malabar spinach really loves the heat also, I found. The water spinach, which may be illegal to grow depending on where you are. Like in my state, it's legal. Here it may be legal, I'm not exactly sure, but that really loves the heat, grows 6 inches in the heat. So that's another one you want to look into if you want some leafy greens in the summertime. Oh, of course, moringa.
Oh.
I think you chopped yours down. I saw it chopped.
Yeah.
But yeah, moringa, number one leafy green to grow here in Phoenix, because it'll stay alive year round. You'll never get rid of it, and yeah, it'll be a weed and you have to cut it down.
Yeah.
It's a prune.
And it's prolific as I'll get out. You know, I cut it down like that every year.
Wow.
The trunks are
comes back
that big around, and it'll be 14, 16 feet tall here in the next 90 days.
Wow. Yeah, that's number one edible leafy green, and they're anti-cancer too, you know, very powerful food there. So Greg, we've covered a lot. I don't want to take your whole day and I gotta run. So are there any final comments or tips or tricks you'd like to share with my viewers today before we sign off?
Thanks. Yes, so this is the urban farm. I've lived here for 32 years. We do tours occasionally.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, we do tours occasionally, and about 4 or 5 years ago there was this young lady that came on the tour, and she sheepishly stuck up her hand at the end of the tour and she said, "Oh my gosh, this is so overwhelming. How do I even start?" And what you have to remember is I've been here 32 years. I've been here more than half of my life. And this developed over time. And it started with looking at what's happening in the space and how can I work in the flow, again, permaculture, work in the flow of nature, and then take on a small piece at a time. Don't take on too much. You know, maybe what there is for you to do for starters is plant some basil in a pot in a windowsill. Maybe you have a front porch and there's pots on the front porch. Plant lettuce in the winter. Plant some squash in the summer. So start slow. So, because what happens is, if you get to a place where you do too much and it starts failing, because I guarantee you, you're going to fail.
Yeah.
I promise you, I've killed more plants than you have. Not on purpose. It just happens.
He's killed more than me because he's been doing it longer.
There you go. There you go. And it's just a process of learning. So be patient with yourself. Be patient with yourself and just try. And then when you do fail, that's how we learn.
Exactly. Wow.
Thanks for coming out to the Urban Farm today, John.
Thanks for having me, Greg.
Oh, yeah.
Appreciate it so much. It's good to kind of see the progress you've made and the changes and things. It's been so amazing. And just, you know, hanging out with you every time, I learned so much. This guy's a wealth of knowledge.
Mm,
you know, luckily
thanks.
For you guys, you know, a lot of his content is now available online. No matter, even if you don't live in Phoenix, can't do a tour, take one of his classes he's given over the many years. And because of COVID, he's got an online format. So once again, Greg, you want to share that website so people can learn about how to build their soil? Because if you don't get anything else through this video, I want you guys to sign up for his email list. What is that again?
HealthySoilHacked.com.
HealthySoilHacked.com. Put the link down below. Make sure you click it. Sign up. Build your soil. Have the best soil. And then you too, after 32 years, can have an amazing place just like Greg here. So Greg, thanks a lot for having me come out today. I'll look forward to visiting you in the future when I come back to Phoenix. And if you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, be sure to share this with other people. If you know people that live in Phoenix that want to get inspired by what Greg has done here, share this video so that they can see it too, learn more about building healthy compost and healthy soil and all the different fruit trees and vegetables you guys can grow in Phoenix. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes. I come out in 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. I'm still here in Phoenix for a few more days. Have a few more cool episodes coming out for you guys. And also make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes, including the episodes I have linked down below where I came here like 5-6 years ago, where it was a totally different place and my videos were not as good. But hey, I'm having fun in life. And still doing it, man, to change the world, to make a difference just much like Greg is, to try to teach people to be more sustainable on the planet, grow your own food instead of overfishing those oceans.
So, I got one more real quick cool thing. So when John was here today, one of my neighbors drove by and he texted me and he said, "Is that John Kohler filming in your yard?" I said, "Yeah, it is." He said, "I love John. I bought a juicer because of him." That's the difference you make for people, man. I love it.
Thank you, man. Yeah. I mean, I've been doing this a long time, and I'm glad to be alive. I almost lost my life when I was younger, and I was given a second chance by God, whomever you believe in. And, you know, part of my life is to live in service, and that's why I do what I do.
Yep.
And I love what I do. I would not want to sit and watch a football game today. I would rather come here and make a video to share with you guys, more importantly, learn myself, make the world a better place one person at a time, because you can make a difference. You could plant that one basil plant in your windowsill today.
Woo!
Plant some, grow some sprouts and microgreens indoors, even if it's the winter time when you're watching this. We can all make a difference by offsetting the food that we're buying, or, you know, getting from the oceans or from land animals and factory farming and all this stuff. Just do it yourself. And my videos could help. Over 1,500 videos I have made in the past, over the past 12 years now, teach you guys all aspects about gardening. And surely one of my videos or another will definitely get you excited about gardening. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.